show. Welcome everyone, welcome to the journal, where we bring you daring documentaries. I'm your host, Marcel Legault.
And I'm Jennifer Van Dusen, here to bring you the latest hard-hitting works of art from the students here at Centennial College.
So, the first doc that we're going to take a look at, we're going to dive into a tribute about an all-ages concert hall known as the Big Bop. Let's take a look.
Ten words to describe the Big Bop. I don't know if I can count to ten, but let's try. One would be chaos.
Launchpad. Insanity.
Am I allowed to swear? F***ing amazing times.
Crust.
Drunks.
Paramedics. Fun.
A lot of work. In all ages.
The Big Bop started in 85, early 80s, as a DJ nightclub, and it was the place to go to in the late 80s. But then in the 90s, other nightclubs popped up in the district, in the DJ district. So since the Big Bop was a little outside of downtown, you know, they went under or whatever. So we came in, we took it over in 96 and converted it from a DJ nightclub into a live venue. And we had these ideas of bringing big bands there, but we couldn't really compete against the more established live venues. So what we did was, whenever we did shows, we were doing all ages.
It was key. It was a key part of our scene because, you know, when I started going there, I was, I don't know, like 14. And that opened my eyes to so many opportunities and so many sick bands at the time. So many people, it was a sense of community at that age. You know, you're all growing up together. If that wasn't there, as I was saying before, like, I don't know where I would, what I'd be doing right now, like straight up.
Even though it was a lot harder to run, to maintain and everything else because of kids and all ages, and we had to watch our license and everything else, that was basically what we had to do, and that's why a lot of kids, 14, 15, whatever, got attracted to the Big Bop, because there was a place for them to play. There was a venue for them to go and play.
One last to all those kids out on the street.
Bring back the youth.
One last to all those new friends that you meet.
Bring back the youth.
With the love of God, you can't find them anywhere.
Bring back the youth.
Cause they're business and
the people. It was a disgusting, awesome place. And all the places around here were sort of like that. Even the bank across the street was closed. It was like, today it's a Starbucks. God forbid, we need another Starbucks across from a Starbucks, but you know, they're selling tables out of what used to be a goddamn place that I played in. It's the whole f-ing destruction of our culture.
I drive down that street and I can't believe it is what it is. It's a complete 180. And I almost have to, like, you know, get the crust out of my eyes. I can't believe it, that it is what it is now. I mean, it's a complete change. And it's definitely sad to see it go. I've never been in that furniture store. I don't know if they're successful, but I don't know. I think it would have been more successful if it was still the Big Bop.
I love the way the CB2 looks. I think it looks f***ing great. That building probably by now would have fallen over and somebody would have gotten hurt if it was still open. I mean, it was getting to the point where the amount of money that would have had to have gone in to make the place a viable venue still wasn't going to be available for the fact that, for all the nostalgia that people have about the place, last couple of years there weren't very well attended.
What do you think would need to be done in order to kind of restore an all-ages scene?
I don't know.
Everyone's waiting for someone else to do something. No one's ready to be that person that's like, hey, I'm gonna be that guy to change it and bring it back. Because there's opportunities, there's venues in Toronto that we could do all ages and take it over. But it's a lot more, you know, people are a lot more cautious nowadays when it comes to setting up shows and, like, turning a venue into an all-ages venue.
Because, let's face it, the kids break in the drywall, they kick the doors in, they knock out the f***ing urinals. They're a pain in the ass, right? That's what punk rock kids do. That's what I did when I was their age. So, and the liability, the stage diving, you know, all it takes is one kid to break his neck and then the venue's done.
Maybe it'll take Don getting something downtown again.
Queen is not the same. They pulled the Purple Heart right out of our city.
You wanna know what sucks, Jen?
What, Marcel?
The fact that an entire generation of kids is never gonna know what the cathedral washroom smells like.
Well, I agree, because I definitely don't know what it smells like. But dancing has always been fun, but with passion comes pain.
Broken toes, I think that's pretty standard. I think every dancer has at least 100 of those. Ripped and shredded tendons. What else have I had? Oh, torn groin. Twisted ankles, but I don't think those count. I mean, right now I actually think I may have broken my foot, but I've been still walking on it. My back, I have a major back problem. I didn't sustain that initially from dance, but it progressively got worse with dance. My name is Carrie Bruff, AKA Miss Carrie. I've been dancing since I was 3. So technically about 600,000 years for sure. Yeah, when the dinosaurs roamed. Yeah, so a long time, definitely. I use lollipop as the pain word, like it's the threshold where you can't go beyond that, and it means something is gonna snap or fall off or dislocate or be forever broken. That's the where you stop and you say, I have to allow myself to take time off and to heal and to go to whatever therapeutic methods and medicinal or health course you take. But a lot of the injuries as a dancer, you're always gonna feel something. And if you don't, you're not dancing hard enough. I do believe that, and stretching is important. Hello, my motto, keep stretching. Stretch, 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 stretch. Everything's worth it once you get on stage. If you're a performer or in entertainment, whatever project it is you're working on, I think any element of roadblocks or failings or any negative that comes your way that hinders you is definitely worth it at the end when you're still doing what you love to do. And for a dancer, obviously, it's getting on stage. It is part of the process, but is the pain worth it? Yeah, I guess it is worth it. I don't think you think about the pain when you're on stage anyway. The adrenaline kicks in and the overwhelming, I think you numb that pain, and I think that's like that with any athlete or dancer. You don't think about it until after. However, being a dance teacher, dancing through major injuries and not VIPing them a little bit and taking that time to regroup and build up everything else around it and rest, to some degree for a dancer, you will have permanent damages.
Ouch, dance should definitely be considered a sport with that many injuries. Next up, another interesting form of art, street busking.
Shaking all over.
Probably started last year down on the beach, just in the hot days, like it was 36 Celsius down there, and I was out there on the beach where they were playing volleyball.
Yeah.
And it was fun just to go and watch and play, and it was great. But, you know, the coin wasn't very good. I was there to play, really. I was just there to play. My top dollar was $4. Like, people down there don't hand out money. I think they're very tight on the beach. Honestly, they're I'm serious. But this is only my seventh time on Yonge Street. If you're lucky, you'll make 50, 60 bucks for a whole day, though. I don't have a job. I'm like 50-odd years old, and I had a brain tumor. It leaked. I'm on brain pills right now. I'm on brain pills. And my dad died. I ended up with the house, and the lawyer did not give me enough information. So I ended up on ODSB, right? ODSB, help benefits, ODSB. So the lawyer didn't give me enough money. Next thing I know, I'm on the street now, playing to just try and feed myself, my cat and my dog and I, honestly. I got like $3,000 worth of bills at home. I'm not gonna lie to you, at least three grand right now I gotta pay. Now how am I gonna pay house tax, land tax, you know, the taxes for the house, water and all this crap. You know how much I make? I make basically $500 a month. That's all I get. And that's not with ODSP at all, because I'm not on ODSP. I'm not on anything. Like, I know the system is hard. Like, it's a hard system. Let's face it, like, things are going wrong in it. But don't take people like me and shove them, you know, off to the side. I wouldn't have to do this. I got a major headache anyway, honestly. I shouldn't be here. The cold is killing my hands. It's starting to bleed again. Look, you see the bleeders? It's starting to come out again. The other day that I was bleeding all over the drums here. From here, there, oh, there's another one coming up. He just popped right out. Boom, start bleeding, eh? Anyway, I'm having a hard time. Like, you think about suicide once in a while? Well, I have thought about it a lot, but I don't, you know? Like, why bother? It's a waste of time. Whatever you, the guitar player, goes and looks at me and says we're playing this or that and gives me a little hum, you know, then I play. See, it's just normal, like, playing, that's all.
Now that is one talented drummer. Now, in December of 2012, Stephen Harper passed Bill C-45, or what's known as the Jobs to Growth Act, which affects a lot of Canadians. Let's take a look at some of Centennial students and see how much they know about it.
C-45. I have no idea. On
Bill C-45. I don't know.
I don't know about Bill C-45.
I'm not entirely sure, actually.
No.
Who is Chief Teresa Spencer? I don't know.
No.
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 No. Who is Chief Theresa Spencer? She's probably somebody important.
Do you know about the Idle No More movement?
No.
No. No.
I've heard a little bit about it, but not too much.
Actually, I know a lot about it. I don't know the roots behind it. I know they're protesting some of the issues within Bill C-45. What Bill C-45 details, I have no idea, but I know that's the main reason why they're protesting, and I know these protests have been going on across Canada for a while now.
Yes, I do know about the PlayStation 4.
Yes.
Do you know that Sony just released a new PlayStation 4?
Of course. Yes, did it release already, the PlayStation 4? I heard that it's not backwards compatible, which sucks. And you have to pay, your friends can't borrow it. Like, you gotta pay each time you buy a game. No?
No.
I know it exists.
Thank you.
It matters to me, and I will definitely, definitely get at least two.
I guess it does matter to me because I like playing video games a lot. And will I get one? Probably, but we'll have to wait and see. I don't know. There's not a lot of information yet, but still. Somehow I know a lot of information about that.
All right, Jen, so here's $1 million question. Do you know about Bill C-45?
Sadly, I don't know about Bill C-45, but the new PS4 I do know about. Well, to move along, up next is the Good Neighbors Club, where a place where impoverished men over 50 can get assistance and counseling. Let's take a look.
This isn't typical social work, where people come in, they have an appointment, and they have a form for you to fill out. This is more proactive.
I mean, this is part of the cycle, right? When you're homeless or you live in these shelters, right? You tend to gravitate towards those places which are convenient for you. That's the reality of it all. You know, when you have a great job, you tend to gravitate toward great things, right? So here I am, guys, trying to climb out. So
we told this club, I've been just walking the streets, looking for job, no access to a lot. There is places, there's computers, which I'm unaware of everywhere. Probably it's close or far. It's much more further. Here's the closest one to the shelter. So it's very, very, other than that, I'll be walking the streets, job searching. And it wouldn't be the same as here, because if you're out in the cold, you know, you're not sheltered, you're walking in minus temperature, walking the street to and from all these hours. So without the Good Neighbors Club, it's very hectic.
I've been hanging around this club for about 4 or 5 years now, as a volunteer first, then as a board member, and now as a staff member. I have seen such tremendous strides taken here.
This club is blessed with wonderful professionals who are willing, able and willing to deliver, you know, 100% professional services to these marginalized members. But we don't have enough money to do so.
5 years ago, there were no social workers. There's no housing worker, no community worker, no outreach around us, nothing. 5 years ago, this organization had never even employed a woman.
So far, my experience at the club has been really amazing. All the guys are so great. Our members are true gentlemen. They hold the door open for you. They always check in on me to see how I'm doing, make sure that I'm happy and content here. And all the employees have been so warm and welcoming. It's such a nurturing and loving environment to work in.
The members are wonderful. A lot of members are very experienced. They've done a lot of wonderful things in their lifetime. So we draw from their knowledge to do whatever we need to do. And each time you come here, you learn a new thing from them. And we treat each other with respect. They respect us, we respect them. And we learn from each other. Of course we need funding. We need a lot of funding we need money from the government. Government needs to see the wonderful work that we do here. We don't have enough because we rely on public donations, on generosity of individuals, public organizations.
Right now we're confronted with some space issues because the demand for our club's amenities goes up every year, and we constantly have new members joining, and to provide services to those members we also need more staff.
If we can get enough funding, there are wonderful works that we can do to help our members here who are men, marginalized, homeless, and who have a lot of health issues, addiction problems, and we don't have enough to help them the way we should.
We're not part of an umbrella organization like the Salvation Army. We're not part of a large organization like Wood Green or Fred Victor, which means that we have a lot of flexibility to focus in on our demographic, which nobody serves quite as well as we do. That's older, marginalized men.
This is one of a kind club that provide the kind of services that we do provide. Counseling, recreational therapy, older men activities, you know, games, treatment, referrals to clinics, nursing, housing, referrals, all kind of things that we do here.
We really have to reach out and tell our story, to get our message across and make sure that donors realize there's no better bang for your buck than at the Good Neighbors Club.
Are we going to get there? It depends on the funding from the City of Toronto.
That doc is a real eye-opener. It's something that some of our fellow friends at Centennial might not know, is that Eric Lawrenson actually volunteered there, so I do hope they get the funding they need. Up next is a doc about a young woman and her story about loneliness and abuse. Let's take a look.
The loneliness is the best part. You strive to stay and be alone. Your friends. You stop talking to people because all you want is to be alone. After feeling like you're trapped in a soundproof box, you start to find it more peaceful in there. The box begins to feel like home. I would just stand in the middle of the room, or sit on the bed waiting for what I knew was coming. Loneliness is home. So you get rid of anything and everything that takes away from that home feeling.
That's really tragic, Marcel. I can't imagine how much strength is needed to be able to endure that type of pain. Now let's dive into the mind of an artist.
Thank you.
is Wes Nellen. I'm 21 years old, and I'm from Toronto. I guess it took me a while to find specifically illustrating or what I'm currently doing mostly now. But for the most part, I've always been drawing and making things. I never really liked sports much when I was a kid, so. Yeah, I had lots of time to doodle things. I'm exploring this idea of home and community for it's been about 2 years now, and I keep saying that I'm gonna stop and I'm gonna do something else, but it keeps coming back to that. And it's a little bit frustrating, but it just goes to show that there's more to this idea that I just haven't figured out yet. There's a lot to be said about the idea of home. This idea of building a community and then having it just completely fall apart kind of interests me, I guess. And the human aspect of the side of home and how it interlays into that idea. Yeah, trying to represent the darker side of life, but in a way that is so illustrated and cute, I guess. Yeah, in terms of process work, I do sketch things out and write ideas, but I try to just save all my energy for my final pieces because I feel like imperfections and flaws and stuff just kind of add to the overall painting. My last show was called Broke, Bored, and Slightly Depressed. It was a series of paintings illustrating different towns that have gone through natural disasters and things of the like. There's kind of a recession theme for it, I guess, in a sense, but not so much in a literal sense. I go to OCAD, and there's this one guy, Eric, who, all we do is spend our time together drawing. It's really great. Basically how I spend my free time. It's kind of depressing, I guess, that I'm 21 and such a recluse, but I just can't handle that shit, you know? Yeah, it's just, I just don't get it. You just always, you go out and you get drunk and then you come back and you go home and you fall asleep, and I'm like, you didn't gain anything from that except some empty calories, you know? I guess you live fundamentally for your senses and to feel this undying satisfaction for something more, and yeah, if you don't explore that, then it's pointless.
Next week, we have a whole new lineup with more hard-hitting documentaries. Thank you for tuning in into an episode of The Journal. I'm your host, Jennifer Van Dusen.
And I'm Marcel Legault, and stay stoked, Centennial.
Oh, don't you?